Hello, glad you could make it. Welcome to the PSFC. Today we're going to be taking a tour of the Alcator CMOD Tokamak Laboratory. We learned about tokamaks in 3.2. Our tour guide today is a graduate student here at MIT, Alex. I'll catch up with you after the tour. Have fun.
Welcome everyone. Let's head on in and see Alcator CMOD. Welcome everyone to the power room, which is the room we're standing in right now. So as you learned about earlier in this series, when we make a fusion plasma, we confine it with really, really powerful magnets. And in order to turn these magnets on, we use almost 100 megawatts of electricity every time we run Alcator CMOD. And so this room in the power room is where we take all that electricity and divide it up to power different parts of the tokamak. So some of the power goes to the heating system, some goes to the magnet, some goes to other parts of the tokamak. And once we've divided it up in the power room, we then send it through the wall here into Alcator CMOD, into the cell, and use it to run the machine. So after this, we'll walk into the cell and see Alcator CMOD. So we're now in the cell, and the machine behind me is Alcator CMOD. So before I talk too much about the machine itself, I'll point a little bit to this diagram here and explain a few things about the different pieces inside the machine. So the plasma is this red or orange donut kind of moving around here in the middle of the machine that we confine with these magnets which go right around the machine here. And all of that is inside this big concrete dome on the outside. And that dome is what you can see behind me. All that blue stuff is concrete. So the machine itself is inside there, but we have a bunch of other stuff around the machine. So when we make this plasma, this, you know, maybe 100 million degrees or however hot it is, we need to measure it. We want to learn from it. We're trying to do science here. So we measure temperature, we measure density. We basically, any way that we can think of measuring something and anything we can think of measuring, we build a diagnostic, we have install that on the machine, and we use that to measure the plasma. So I can point out a few of them while I'm here. So one of the things I'll point out is down here, there's actually a probe that what it does is it taps very quickly the edge of the plasma. So you can't really put a thermometer in the plasma or you'd melt your thermometer. But if you're very quick and very careful about it, you can actually use a metal probe and tap the edge of the plasma just to see what's going on in the edge. That's one way we measure the plasma. Other things I'll point out, up here we have some diagnostics that measure temperature. So one of the things I like to explain is if you have a piece of metal and it gets a little bit hot, it turns like red. And you heat it up even more, it turns white. So based on the color of the metal, you can tell how hot it is. We also do something similar in the plasma. It's not quite the same, but it's similar. That based on the frequency of the light that comes out and the intensity, how much light, you can tell how hot the plasma is at a given location. So some of that data is taken out here in the top in these little copper pipes. We call that electron cyclotron emission, and that's one of the things that I work on personally. Some other things I can point out is we want to make a hot plasma, and so you can't just, you know, put it in the oven. It's not going to get quite to 100 million degrees, but we use basically giant microwaves. So if you think of like a microwave in your house, that's maybe a kilowatt, but we use megawatts of electricity to heat up the plasma, and those are actually sent through pipes up here. So we generate them on the other side of the room. And then think about like a giant fiber optic cable. So it's a light pipe. The light kind of comes through these pipes and is fired into the machine down here on these copper pipes that are now covered up with foil. And these are actually car radio frequencies. So think of your car radio. The frequency of these waves is exactly the same as that, but it operates almost like a microwave in your house. So I can show you a lot of other diagnostics, but let's step down and look at some of those now. So now we're standing by one of the ports for Alcator CMOD. So these are right in here. If you want to get inside the machine to do maintenance, to do some upgrades, to change something, you have to crawl through this port right here. And it's a pretty tight fit. So I've been in the machine, some other people have been in the machine as well, but there's maybe only 10 or 15 people in the lab that will physically fit inside the machine. And why did they make the port so small? It's not to be mean. It's because the magnets for Alcator CMOD are so powerful that they take up a lot of space. So the magnets are spaced right next to each other, and it turns out that there's only about that much space in between the magnets. So if you want to put a port, it has to fit between the magnets, and that's the space you have to crawl through. So once you get inside, you can kind of crouch down, you can crawl around a little bit, but you can't stand up if you want to do any maintenance. On the other hand, The powerful magnets of Alcatraz CMOD are actually one of its big advantages. So the very strong magnets allow you to have a very hot, dense plasma in a very small space. And that's actually what allowed Alcatraz CMOD to have the volume average pressure record of any tokamak in the world at the end of 2016, where the very high magnetic field approached, the strong magnets of Alcatraz CMOD. So the most of the structure actually of Alcatraz CMOD is steel, keeping the magnets together. And the space inside is where the actual plasma is, and that's all just surrounded by the magnets and the superstructure used to keep them together. So now we'll head up to the top of Alcatraz CMOD and see a few extra things up there. So we're now standing on top of Alcatraz CMOD, and I'll show you a few things while we're up here. So as I said before, we want to measure every aspect of the plasma in Alcatraz CMOD that we can. And one of those is the density of the plasma. How much plasma is there in any given volume of space? And one way we can do that is by shooting a laser through the plasma and basically seeing how long it takes to get through the plasma. So is it slowed down a little bit as it goes through the plasma? And so up here we have a laser system that will shoot that laser through the plasma. Here we have just have a big tank of liquid helium that cools various aspects of the system and makes sure that the system is operating properly. So also, if you look over here to my right, your left, you'll see a bunch of other systems that we use to heat the plasma. So this is another type of heating system, in addition to the one you saw earlier, that generates waves and then pipes them through these little copper tubes here, the square ones, and that goes into the machine in the side and also heats up the plasma inside. So now that we've seen the top of Alcatraz CMOD, we'll head back out into the control room where we analyze the data, where it's a little bit easier to talk, it's not quite as loud in there, and continue our conversation.
We're standing now in the control room, and Alex is going to say a little bit more about how we actually operated Alcatraz CMOD from this room.
So as Ann just mentioned, this is a control room. So when the machine itself is running in the cell, all the scientists and grad students and professors and everyone are in this room in order to run the machine itself. So most of these desks are for people taking their own individual data, so temperature, density measurements, all this kind of stuff. And some of the stuff up here on the projectors is information that maybe everyone wants to know.
So there's two very important people playing a role when we run an experiment at any tokamak, actually, in the world. And here in the control room, they would sit at these machines right behind me, at these two computers. Maybe you can say a little bit about that?
Yeah, exactly. So the person in charge of the experiment, to some extent for the day, is the session leader. And so they're the one deciding what kind of science you want to do, what kind of physics you want to measure. And the other person is the physics operator. And they're kind of in charge of taking that scientific goal and translating it into how do I want to run the machine.
So what is a typical plasma going to look like if we were to, say, visualize it with a camera?
Great, yeah. So actually the picture on the left there, on the far left, is a video of the inside of the machine during operation. So you see the kind of bright area around the edges and the cool area, the see-through area in the middle. And so that's actually showing a 2-second discharge, slowed down a little bit, in order to make it easier to see. And that's actually our record-breaking discharge from the end of 2016, where we set the volume average pressure record in a tokamak.
So there's a few counterintuitive things about that video behind us now. Can you say a few words, Alex, about the parts that look really bright and the parts that aren't so bright, actually, that seem a little invisible, we can see through them?
Sure. So the middle of the plasma is actually so hot that it emits X-rays rather than visible light. So if you look at the video, the section in the middle that you can see through, that's actually the hottest part of the plasma. And it's the sections around the edge that are glowing brightly that are the quote-unquote cold parts of the plasma that are only, quote-unquote, 10,000 degrees rather than 100 million degrees. And those are cool enough that they'll emit infrared light and visible light, and you can pick them up on a camera like that.
So it's actually really interesting, because when we talk about heating up a piece of metal, we talk about it getting red hot and then white hot. But if we think about heating up a plasma, it has to get invisible hot. By the time we reach the 10 kiloelectron volt temperatures that we described in the lectures that we need to achieve fusion, you can't see a plasma anymore because it's coming out in the non-visible wavelengths.
Yeah, and so in addition to the visible video of the plasma, we also show a few other things. So we show a cross-section of the plasma. So basically, if you have your plasma donut, and you take a little slice out of it, we call that a cross-section. And so that's what you see up there on the right. So that's the red is the edge of the plasma, the blue is inside, the white is the outside. And on the far right, we also show some information about what's going on in the plasma. So, current, magnetic field, density, heating power, other things that we're using to other things that you'd like to know about the plasma.
So for this particular plasma, this was a record shot that Alcator CMOD produced, right? And what was the record? What was so special about it?
Right, so we set the volume average pressure, so the most pressure inside of a tokamak ever in the world, is about 2 atmospheres. And the reason you want pressure is because fusion power is really just based on the pressure. So the more pressure you have in the tokamak, the more fusion power you can get out. And it turns out that Alcator CMOD is really great at making this high pressure.
So I was going to ask, why is it so great at making this high pressure? What was the magnetic field? What was the plasma current that we ran this tokamak at? We're going to be learning in the lectures in 3.2 and 3.3, we're going to be learning about those two parameters and how important they are for confinement and stability. So maybe you can say a bit about them.
Yeah. So Alcator CMOD, one of the reasons that the machine is so has such high performance is that it is very high magnetic field. So this particular discharge was run a little bit over 5 tesla, so something like 5.6, 5.7 tesla, compared to most machines in the world which run maybe up to 2 or 3 tesla at tops. We also ran more than 1.5 mega amps of current inside the machine. So that current also helps confine the plasma and keep it inside. So because Alcator CMOD can run at such high magnetic field and high current, you can have a very small, compact machine, which still has performance that is equal to or better than much larger machines in other areas around the world.
That's a fantastic segue to a lot of the discussion that we're going to hear in 3.3 of the lectures online and the lecture notes. We're going to be talking about the high field path to fusion, which MIT has really been pioneering for many, many years with the Alcator CMOD tokamak being one of the major experiments in that history. And we're looking ahead to the future now, where we'd like to build a compact device which can allow us to achieve a fusion power gain of capital Q greater than 1. Remember, capital Q was one of the metrics that we were talking about in 3.2 that help us describe the performance of a plasma, how good it's doing on the path to fusion. And so later on in the series, we're going to be discussing the Spark tokamak, which is something Alex might want to say a little bit more about before we leave, and the high field path to fusion that MIT is pushing ahead with.
So yes, as Anne mentioned, MIT would like to build this machine called Spark. And the idea of Spark is basically take the, you know, the path of Alcator CMOD, take this high field compact path, and scale it up just a little bit bigger, and use some technology that has only recently been developed. So you may at some point hear about yttrium barium copper oxide, this high temperature superconductor.
They'll hear about it.
They'll hear about
yes,
it.
Yes, we're going to talk all about that in 3.3.
Excellent. And we'll use this new material, this new superconducting material, to build a tokamak, this Spark tokamak, which will have fields that are much higher than even the 5 or even 8 tesla in Alcator CMOD, maybe up to 11 or 12 tesla. And with this really powerful magnetic field, you can have a relatively small device which confines the plasma well enough to get this capital Q, this break-even point of greater than 1. And this, you know, generate net energy from your tokamak for the first time in the world.
So we really have a blend of going forward with the basic plasma physics and the basic tokamak physics that we and other labs around the world have been establishing for decades. Combining that with new technologies recently available, we can accelerate the path to fusion, fusion in time to make a difference for humanity. So with that, Alex, I think we should tell everyone thanks for joining us.
Thanks for joining us.
Goodbye, everybody.